the Strange Edition.
The previous
killing,
of Las Películas Sábados Gigantes at the Cine Marijuana Theater.
Woo! Now with theme music.
Yes.
Yay.
Top notch new theme song by Czar Destroyer.
Yes.
Bringing us in.
Yes. Welcome. We are the Cine Marijuana Theater, in particular Las Películas Sábados Gigantes at the Cine Marijuana Theater. And we have a movie lottery weekly where we watch stuff and then we talk about it. And that's what we're here to do today, is talk about it.
Not a complicated process.
Exactly, yes. We are here to discuss the film 1941.
Year did that come out?
That came out in 1979. I know searching for this film is kind of a bitch because it wants to go, the year 1941 in film. Like, no. The film 1941 of the year.
Of the year 1979.
Of the year from the year 1979. Steven Spielberg's 1979. I believe this is his fourth film.
I think so, yeah. Yeah, he had some real blockbusters prior to this,
which
explains a lot.
Let me just double check on that, the order of his film. But we watched 1941, excuse me, that was picked by Cine Marijuana Theater member Condi, who actually is not with us today.
Unfortunately, he died.
Yes, he is dead. Yeah. And so
we'll never know why he picked it.
No, we won't.
You won't. I won't. Nobody will.
Nobody. In fact, we kind of tried to ask when it was over last time, but he was out of here so fast that nobody could find out.
Yeah, I think his response was a quick double bird.
Yeah.
As he disappeared out the door.
So hopefully
he had to go die.
Hopefully yeah, he was late
to
the
appointment.
He's smiling in the afterlife. So before we get started, and we are waiting on a late arrival, Zeb's going to be here. He's not here yet, but he is going to be here.
It turns out this is the fifth film of Steven Spielberg's.
Is it? I just got it up.
You don't count TV movies.
Okay. The Last Gun, Fighter Squad, Escape to Nowhere, Firelight, Slipstream, and Amblin. Are those all films?
No, I don't think any of those count. Like
no,
short films.
No.
Those are all episodes. Yeah, Slipstream is an episode of Columbo.
It would be Firelight, and then there's a bunch of TV movies. So if you want to count those, sure. Then Sugarland Express, Jaws.
Duel was for TV too.
Well,
wasn't
but Duel saw a theatrical release.
So Duel is
in Europe. So
okay,
I mean,
so Duel counts.
I count Duel as his first.
Then Close Encounters, then 1941.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So his fifth film, then. There we go. A fifth proper film, anyways, of Señor Spielbergo. Before we dive into it, let's do introductions, starting with me and going clockwise. I'm Ed.
This is John.
I'm Kenzie.
I'm Crispy.
Jason.
I'm Matt.
So let's get it cracking, yeah? Let's go to Wildcard Kenzie for our synopsis. Kenzie, if you would please give us a synopsis of 1941.
If you give me the lighter.
Yes.
Okay, I'll try.
Please.
So there was some war stuff, some Pearl Harbor stuff, the Zoot Suite Riot stuff.
The Zoot Suite Riot stuff.
You know when people had those rooms that were called Zoot Suites that used to hang
yes,
out in?
Yes, yes. All too well.
Based on.
I'm a huge fan of Zoot Suite culture myself. Whenever I travel. I try to make sure my accommodations are.
I like to stay exclusively in
Zoot Suites. Line with those kind of cultural parameters.
Zoot Suite Riot, paying
Riot.
To stay.
Yeah. Do you see that Zoot Suite?
So back to the Zoot Suite stuff.
I can hardly go on. I'm sorry. There was a girl who had an airplane fetish.
And the sexual predator who took full advantage of that.
Nancy Allen.
He tried to manipulate her.
No. Hang on. I'm going to mark that for conversation later.
Yeah, later. Not during the synopsis.
Yeah. Well, keep going. Keep synopsizing.
There was an angry couple
dead fucking
because the government was trying to force a bomb in their yard, and they did. And that's pretty much it.
A bomb.
Yeah,
I recall the scene where Ned Beatty operated the bomb.
Yeah, he sat right at the controls of the bomb.
and operated the shit out of it.
Yeah, and it was weird because the bomb shot out smaller bombs.
Yeah, it did. Yeah. It was crazy. It was like,
yeah, I remember when they showed him
it
how
was
to
like
use
a
the
mama bomb.
Bomb.
Yeah, that was making birth little baby bombs.
Yeah, they showed him how to use the bomb. They're like, load the bombs into this bomb, then whatever yeah. You do not pull back this bomb, and engage this bomb.
Yes. Yes. So in case you're listening to us and you hadn't seen 1941 from 1979 and you were thinking about it, certainly that synopsis has won you over. You're definitely going to want to get to your Netflix account.
Oh, there's KKSM right Superstar away. Zeb right there.
Zeb is
oh,
right, right, John. Well, you go ahead and
rap, tap, tap at the door.
Grant Zeb ingress to the Cinemarijuana Theater. I thought that was my notes.
Yeah, 1941.
Yeah.
Okay.
That'd be great if you started talking about them.
Okay, so let's do it again. No, let's not do anything again.
Just silence, right?
No. Yeah. I guess
continue.
Just silence. All right, like
so
silence.
1941.
All right, here we go. Yeah. All right, we are joined by Cinemarijuana Theater, Zeb Navarro.
Hey.
Finally. So we've already done introductions and synopsis. So we'll start with you. 3 minutes.
Oh,
3 minutes on the
right
timer.
On the spot.
Right on the spot.
Right on the spot.
Surprise.
Avoiding death and dismemberment.
3 minutes on the timer, Zeb.
Possible assault on a Mexican family.
Tell us what you thought about 1941 from 1979. Go.
First time I saw this film, I didn't know what to think of it, mainly because I was pissed off from the soft focus photography.
I noticed that.
That was really just like takes away, I feel. But it was kind of like the cinematic, go-to thing of its day. Because if you looked at other films around that era, they were all soft focus photography. Same thing as, I guess, 30 years from now, people will look back on this era of cinema and go, wow, they used a lot of gray palette.
They used a lot of lens flare. Yeah. Everything is
there are
teal.
Lots of explosions.
Everything
yeah.
is teal
and
orange.
Yeah.
Yeah. The city is destroyed at the end of every single movie.
Yeah, it's like, man, they made a lot of comic book movies back in the day.
No shit.
Shit. Like now, they're going to look at that like how I'm looking at 1941. It was, man, there was a lot of soft focus photography. Like, whoever made lenses back then was shit.
Somehow that seems like the better way to go, though.
But thoroughly enjoyed the film. Again, like all films of my childhood and my early teens, I saw it on KTLA, Mr. Tom Hatton.
Yeah.
Before there was Turner Classic Movies, there was KTLA Film Festival
before
with Tom
Hatton. Before Robert Osborne, there was Tom Hatton.
Yeah, and who would give, like, today we're going to see 1941, a movie that John Wayne turned down. And
from that chair in that library he would always sit in with his little projector.
And this movie is just like has just the biggest all-star cast, but a very diverse cast ranging from everybody from John Belushi to Warren Oates to Lionel Standard and Slim fucking Pickens.
Yes, absolutely. Slim Pickens sharing the screen with Toshirô Mifune and Christopher Lee. Like, what could possibly be more awesome?
Surprised the universe didn't collapse just on how much powerful awesomeness you had in one location.
However, I felt like the story was kind of muddled in some areas. I felt they could have fleshed it out. Mm-hmm. Or there were scenes missing. Thanks. Like, they had to pare it down for time.
Exactly.
And according to Mr. Tom Hatton, there was supposed to be a scene of Slim Pickens coming out of the ocean with Christopher Lee, saying that he captured the first Nazi in World War II.
Oh, that would have been rad.
That would have been great.
And there's actually like a still, like Tom Hatton showed a bit of like Christopher Lee all wet and Slim Pickens in his underwear onesie.
Right.
Coming out of the ocean. But I thoroughly enjoyed this film. Great performances throughout. The laughs are not like gut-busting, but they're laughs. They're like absurd laughs. It's great comedy. It's not like the comedy of today, which is mostly, hey, everybody, improvise, say a bunch of weird shit, make a lot of pop culture references, and then we're going to spice it all together, and we're going to call it a comedy film.
Yeah.
Fuck you, Paul Feig.
Yeah.
Paul Fags, I call him. So I enjoyed it. I give it 4 out of 4 stars, and this is one of those movies where it's like, man, just imagine John Wayne in the Robert Stack role. How more awesome this movie could have
been.
Wait,
which one was Robert Stack?
He was the general.
The guy that watched Dumbo.
Dumbo like five.
Wait, did John Wayne turn us down?
John Wayne turned it down because he had cancer.
Oh, shit.
Well, he didn't like the movie.
And he also said you shouldn't make fun of
Pearl Harbor.
He said it was un-American.
He said, quote, "This movie gives me cancer."
Dick Powell gave him cancer when they shot that End of the Conqueror film.
Oh, yeah,
it was
that's
called.
Right. Yeah.
Because they brought all that irradiated sand in, and that's what gave it to him.
That was the curse he got from trying to play a Chinese man.
It was the return of the curse of the creature's cancer.
And also, well, Spielberg kind of gave a nod to John Wayne in the USO hall scene where you have like the sailors and the Marines fighting.
Right.
The theme from The Quiet Man was playing.
Oh, okay. There you go. There you go, Duke. All right, John, take it away. What did you think of 1941?
I'd never seen this movie before, even though it was... Yeah, well, and it's so legendary. It's like one of those things that, like, I never wanted to watch it edited on TV, even though there's not much that would be edited out, really, because it's a Steven Spielberg movie, so it's...
The girl getting dragged underneath the truck to get raped.
That, well, okay, but that's not visually too disturbing. I mean, I'm just saying you have to cut that for TV, necessarily, but they played it for laughs, you know, those old rape jokes.
The good old days of rape jokes.
But so I'd never seen it, so it was great to see it for the first time. I guess it originally should have been our 50th movie, 100th movie, I mean, because Condi wanted to pick that, but we didn't have it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so...
We couldn't get it when he was...
There was no way to get it to stream it, buying it. That's why he actually had to buy the DVD to show it.
I've done that here, though.
I've done it before, too.
That actually makes more sense.
Most times I like to do that, if it's just that I usually already own it.
Yeah.
Like, I'm usually playing from the library, but...
It's nice to have that excuse.
Now, would 1941 have the same gravitas?
I think it would have been a better choice than Summer Wars.
Yeah.
I dare any fuckers to disagree with me, because you won't.
I don't disagree with
that. Even Condi probably wouldn't disagree with that one.
Well, I
but it's like, okay, it was a lot of fun. I mean, I agree that it's a little disjointed, and honestly, because I read it, the original cut was much, much longer. It was like 2.5 hours. So we had to snip things here and there, and I think, unfortunately, you feel that, because you do feel like you're missing little pieces here and there. It feels a little disconnected and stuff. Spielberg, it's sort of vanity piece. I mean, he was riding this high wave on all these successes that he had had. That's why he could kind of like basically do whatever he wanted. The whole opening is spoofing himself with Jaws, and it's like, I don't know, it's sort of funny to be like, oh, like, here's my movie, which, of course, you all know, because you've all seen my movie.
I'm Steven Spielberg. You may remember me as a director of Jaws.
Well, right, exactly.
Here you go.
Yeah. But everybody did see it.
Well, no, I know, but it just, like, you could be a little humble or something, and just the way he packed it with, like, all these stars, like, it's like, oh, I'll put the Blues Brothers in my movie, because that way, they're funny. And then, so the movie will be funny.
Like Toshiro Mifune.
Yeah, just
he's
like, right.
You've seen throwing a ball. Jesus
Christ. No, but if you don't think Spielberg is a huge Kurosawa, and thereby Toshiro Mifune
also,
fan. He's creating this movie. He could put anybody he wants into, basically.
I wish I had that.
This was Steven Spielberg giving himself like a giant like birthday present.
Well, it's not like Mifune couldn't be funny either.
No, well, I'm not saying that at all.
Wasn't in this film.
It's
but.
Just that I feel like this movie, and I think even Spielberg himself sort of agreed that like he almost could have been reined in a little bit on this movie.
Why?
Well, because like I don't know. I think it would have been better.
No.
No.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I'm just saying.
No.
Hey, I'm saying it was
good.
I'm
talking specifically about Toshiro Mifune.
No, not Toshiro Mifune. The movie in general.
Oh, I'm like, don't rein him in.
No, not Mifune. Okay. 1941.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah. I love John Belushi's line at the end when he's like all, you know, turn the sub around. You're taking me to Tokyo. Yeah. Like, he's basically been captured, right? But he makes like it's his idea. Right. Like, if I ever get arrested, I want to be like, I'll like, turn the squad car around. You're taking me to jail. Yes, sir. You got some great performances. It's a lot of fun. It's good, but not great. It could have been great. You've got all the pieces there to make a great movie, but whether maybe they should have like just released his original full 2.5 hour cut, I don't know. But it could be a little better. I'm going to give
Criterion get in on it.
Yeah, that would be awesome. I'm going to give it 3 stars.
Okay. All right.
Maybe
Kenzie.
They can apply some sharpening software to us.
Do some 4K restoration of that.
Tell us about 1941.
Okay. Well, I guess I don't have a sense of humor at all because I hated this movie.
There it is.
Wild card. You knew you were waiting for it.
I mean, there were so many times where everyone was just laughing so hard and I was just like sitting there. I know there was a joke. I saw and recognized the joke, but it just wasn't funny.
Do you ever see like this disparity between us and you and like wonder like where you went wrong?
Card Kenzie.
Yeah.
So there's a certain gap going on here between certain segments of the Cinema Marijuana Theater.
Turns out the first time she knocked on the wrong door.
Hey, we don't know. I mean, her her her
her sense of humor might be far more advanced than ours.
It could be. It could be that she's beyond this.
I mean, wasn't that one of the quotes from who said it? That was like a great movie, but it wasn't funny.
I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it was Stanley Kubrick.
Yeah, Stanley Kubrick. Yeah, Kubrick. Yes, thank you.
Oh, yeah.
That it was a great movie. Yeah, he considered it to be like a drama more than anything.
Sure. Well, he was a serious man.
All right, Kubrick. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
He was a serious man. All right, well, Kenzie, please continue to disparage 1941.
Okay. And everyone else, all you guys love the actors so much. I know who John Candy is.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah. At least there's that.
He's the only one.
Awesome. A good one to know, at least.
Yeah.
You're not a Robert Stack fan?
Who?
You've seen Unsolved Mysteries at some point, right?
The guy that watched Dumbo.
You know, hasn't been involved.
The scary ass theme song.
Okay.
Say that when that movie came out, it was pretty
panned. Well, yeah, that's one of the things I was going to talk about is the reception when it came out. Yeah, it was it didn't do it didn't bomb, but it didn't meet expectations.
Well,
everybody
thought
it was going to
be Jaws. People were
waiting
for another Jaws.
They wanted
Close
to be
Encounters.
Jaws. Yeah.
And then he dick teases them in the beginning with Jaws.
Back then, it just seemed like the studios were just trying to stick Belushi in anything they could.
Well, I think too. I think it was Spielberg though that wanted him because I think it was like a. They were everywhere. They were so popular. Yeah. All right, Kenzie, go ahead. Finish up.
Okay, 2 stars.
No, okay. I wasn't trying to rush. You do still have some time if you'd like to twist the knife a little more.
You still got 2.5 minutes.
Yeah. We still got almost 3 minutes to go.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe if it were a musical and
it's
was
funny
only
you would say
about
that he almost did it as a musical.
Yeah,
he considered it.
He
Spielberg
should have,
did.
And he should have got rid of everything else except the Pearl Harbor storyline and the couple with the girl with the airplane fetish.
Of course.
What Pearl Harbor storyline? There was no Pearl Harbor.
Yeah, huh, there was a Pearl Harbor reference somewhere at the beginning.
They should have kept the guy blowing up his house.
Was it the guy at the house or the guys in the submarine? Which guys was it?
It was the guy with the bomb that shoots bombs.
Oh, yeah, the guy with the bomb. The bomb at his house.
All right,
2 stars?
2 stars.
Okay, all right. That brings it to Chris. Tell us about 1941.
It was a wonderful year. No, just kidding. I think this movie is like Spielberg's, you know, like you have a box of fireworks and you're setting them off. You're like shooting some fireworks, like bottle rockets go off. And like, you know, you have like a couple different types of like fireworks. And then like you realize you're kind of running low. So you just like set them off all at once.
Right.
And it's just kind of like, oh, whoa, what the fuck? Like, that was awesome. I don't know what happened, but
that was rad.
So cool. That's kind of like the feeling I got. It was so funny. I remember it was. I know everybody was enjoying it when we watched it here. You know,
like they had a bunch of different story parts. They didn't quite know what to do with. And like, fuck it, let's just put them all together.
Crash at the end.
Strap it to a big rocket.
Yeah.
Fuck, dude, it'll be up there and bright. You know,
shoot that bomb off.
Yeah. But yeah, no, it was kind of a clusterfuck. But it was. I thought it was funny. I remember laughing a lot. It was cool to see so many people I love in the same movie, I guess, you know, like from so many different things.
I think that's definitely one of the film's strengths.
Of its type, you know, those types of movies where I guess it's just
super
like
cast.
This endless run of cameos or whatever.
Ensemble piece.
Super cast, whatever. It's like, it seems like kind of the king of it, I guess. I had only seen it, I mean, I remember seeing it like maybe once when I was a kid on satellite or something like that, but I just remember... Yeah, I just remember thinking it was cool, like because there's so much special effects and there's so much visual shit going on that as a kid it was cool to
it's
me.
It's pretty epic
and
like that.
I think it still holds that effect as an adult. You know?
Well, that Ferris wheel scene is still, they still talk about that. Like you're watching a special effects and things.
Yeah,
I mean, that scene's legendary.
Yeah. Yeah.
Add that to my list of negatives.
What, you didn't like the fifth part of the Ferris wheel came off?
Okay, Eddie Deason, Bone Zone or not?
No.
Murray Hamilton, Bone Zone or not?
The dummy, Bone
Zone. Yeah, the puppet.
He's in my Bone Zone.
You know Tim Matheson's in the Bone Zone, though. He's got to be.
Matheson.
Right?
Was he the rapist?
Who?
The pilot. The non-pilot. The one who was... After the chick with the
oh yeah purse. He was definitely
okay
yeah.
All right
yeah
all right Chris continue
yeah Shit. I can't remember what I was thinking. But
rating.
Yeah. This gets probably 3 stars. I was thinking more at the time, but in retrospect, it.
You've cooled on it a little bit.
Having 2 weeks to think about it. I think it's a 3-star movie. You know, I end up giving everything 3 stars. I know, but
with the 5-star system, we're kind of limited.
I really,
you think know what I mean. It's pretty broad. Well, we can do that. We can bring that up for discussion. We can change. I'm open to that.
Yeah.
All right. So 3 stars.
Anyway, 3 stars.
All right. Perfect timing.
I guess.
All right. Welcoming back to the podcast after
like the second time.
A lengthy absence.
Yeah, it was like our first
short
one
cameo
now.
When I had a crashing blood sugar.
That's right.
Time to get your land legs.
The one and only Jason Land. All right, tell us what you thought about 1941.
So I never even heard of that movie before, and I'm not a real huge Spielberg fan. It is now my favorite Spielberg film. I've seen plenty of his films, but that is now my favorite Spielberg film. Michael Bay saw this as a trial and said, wait, you can do this as a living? Like Spielberg had a friend in like the special effects department. He's like, well, we got all these like explosion squibs or whatever you call them.
Yeah.
But they're going to expire soon. Like, what do we do with them? And Spielberg is like, don't worry. I have you covered.
I got a plan.
I got a comedy about Pearl Harbor.
Yeah, I'm gonna blow up a bunch of undeveloped L.A. coastline. I'm going to roll a house off of its foundation into the beach.
We got this house all set to roll off and dump into the beach. What are we going to do with it?
An awesome stunt thing that they did.
Hey, Steven, Toshio Mifune's in town. You want to cast him in a movie?
I'm going to roll a Ferris wheel like a pinwheel down the dock. I'm going to have a paint factory for some reason, just have all of its containers, like its reservoirs, just like spill out in this really cool looking
thing.
Oh, yeah,
that was rad.
For no reason.
Just because it looked cool. Just because it looked cool.
It was like, hey, guys, I found a pile of money. Spend it.
Woohoo! And Tim Burton saw that as a kid. He's like, wow, colors are cool.
Yeah, right.
Everyone's ridiculous in it. I didn't recognize hardly any of the actors, so I don't have like this, you know, like, ensemble cast fetish that most of the other guys here have.
It
was definitely absurd. Someone said surreal or absurd or something. Like, I think that was what I really got out of it.
Oh yeah, it was absurd.
Now
absolutely.
Keep in mind, World War II for us basically ends in what, 45, 46?
Yeah,
45.
Yeah.
And this 45. Was this film came out when?
79.
So that's 33-ish. Is that right? 33 years? 34?
45, 75. Yeah, 33.
Yes, 34. 30-ish years later, that's like us in 2032 or something making a slapstick ensemble cast comedy about 9/11 attacks.
Yeah, yeah.
I guess they would. Okay. And we might
like someone's
day.
Asleep at the wheel, at like the you know detecting airplanes coming in like off their course or whatever, and that's gonna be like the Justin Bieber of the day, and like
too soon.
And introducing
Zucker Jr. and Abrams Jr. present.
Yeah.
That has to happen.
We're almost. We should be just about time to be able to do a Gulf War, the first one.
You're right.
Funny.
Well, they already kind of did it. Hot Shots, kind of. Hot Shots lampooned.
And Three Kings.
Three. Oh, okay. All right.
That was
a little more serious.
It was serious, but had some funny parts.
Yeah.
It wasn't straight up a comedy. Which 1941, other than like the rape subplot, was like only a comedy.
Well,
which
was funny. They still played the rape subplot for laughs.
The way it was back in 1979.
Yeah, you could go down.
Yeah,
street,
as usual, you know, guys are like, okay. Wow, this is funny to us.
Wow, he's extra horny.
Actually, the scene where she gets pulled under the Jeep, like that was like a straight up horror movie shot right there. Like that really fucked me up.
Yeah, because you couldn't even see him, right? She just
she sees her, like, kind of rape the guy who she likes. Like she's crawling to go to him and like help me or whatever. And then she just gets pulled screaming under this Jeep. It's like, oh, fucking hell.
It's scary because it's realistic.
We should watch Yellowbeard. That is chock full of rape jokes.
All right,
Jason. So give it to us in stars.
All the stars. All the stars, even Kenzie's discarded stars.
Okay.
Discarded stars and add them to my full stars.
Oh, wow.
That's a lot of stars.
Okay, all right. Dr. Malice.
Yeah.
1941, go.
So I have memories of this movie like from quite a ways back. I mean, this is one of the ones that, like, going to the movie store, the video rental store to, you know, look for a flick.
And I
would always see, like, the cover of it, you know, John Belushi with... you know, in the cockpit, biting down on his cigar,
right.
And I was just like, "Oh, this looks like fun," you know. And it's so I hadn't seen it for like a long time, but It still holds up in a way. I mean, in a way, I can kind of see it. You know, that Stanley Kubrick joke. Like it's
a
definitely
great movie, but not a good
it's
comedy.
Definitely grandiose. Yeah, I mean, yeah. It's got a lot going for it. There's tons of stunts, and you know, the cast is great. I think that maybe Spielberg was trying to like make his own. It's a mad world in a way.
I can definitely see that.
You know,
yeah.
Just like stuffing as many. Let's make stars as you can into a movie.
So much kind
and
of
like,
slapstick things, yeah, things going on.
And just hope that magic will happen.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, there was definitely a lot of jokes in there. I was laughing, you know, pretty hard, as everyone was. There was just kind of, I don't know, maybe like too much of an element of the absurd that, I mean, I know that it's supposed to be like, you know, kind of crazy and out there with...
Well, you definitely don't ever feel that the Japanese are any kind of a real threat.
Well, of yeah.
I mean, they do definitely create this
well,
sort of silliness
I mean,
to the whole thing.
Are you supposed to, though?
Well,
they're trying to blow up.
I mean, I guess the idea of Japan attacking mainland California is pretty laughable.
I think it was more.
Well,
of
no,
a
they were planning for it.
I thought
they
were planning for it.
Yeah, well, they did, but the results were pretty laughable.
I thought it was maybe a play on our paranoia.
It was like some place that made like propane or something. They
did they actually get over here? I think they hit Alaska.
It's partially what this is based on. Yeah. A brown paper bag.
Flaming.
Yeah, one got to like someplace close to Los Angeles and you know, like, yeah, like a refinery or something.
They also tried sending stuff on the jet stream.
Yeah, they sent balloons over.
No, they sent bombs that are still, a lot of them are still out there.
Yeah,
active.
Family got
they're
killed.
They're still floating around.
Balloon bombs, yeah. That's a
no,
real
no,
deal.
No, they're still out in the woods because they land up in the Pacific Northwest.
Yeah,
so they're in the forest.
There's balloon
there.
Bombs.
I'd rather like to think of them just still floating around.
That'd be so cool.
No, but like towards the end where, you know, they think that the Japanese are bombing L.A., so the bright idea is to shoot out all the lights. In one square block.
Yeah, just right. That's going to stop it right yeah. there. Shoot them all out.
Yeah.
But, you know, of course. It's
scathing critique of America.
Or the part where they, like, let the kids start giving orders because he's wearing a fake uniform.
Oh, that was great.
Even though they all know that he's not, like, in the military. Like, well, he's wearing that shirt. We got to do what he says.
The guy who just recently checked out of the fucking Zoot Suite.
Yeah, he was.
The Zoot
Suite.
All you got to... Hey, that's the...
Top floor of the SmackDown Hotel.
The clothes make the man, really.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
But it was good. I mean, it was definitely worth a laugh. I'd recommend it.
All right.
I'd give it 3 stars.
3 stars. All right, that brings it to me. Let's try to get through this as quick as I can before we get... Balls Deep into 1941. That's going to be the name of the segment following. It's going to be Balls Deep. So, first off, I'm going to, after I say what I thought of it, I'm going to give just a list of most of the cast just for the sake of having to say it. It was interesting because I hadn't really seen this before, and it was definitely on my radar. As a fan of a lot of Spielberg's work, definitely this was on the radar as like need to see, and I just hadn't seen it. But at first I like wasn't sure where it was gonna go. So at first I was like, man, this kind of sucks. Like, at first,
that feeling never went away for me.
Yeah,
right. Well, so sorry, this bowl was smoking. I had to do something about it. But then like just
leave
sitting
no
with
bowl
it,
unsmoked.
You know, I sit with it. You know, I let it steep, and it started to work its magic on me, and I started to say, okay, because the one dude that at first jumped out to be the guy who thought the movie was going to be about, I'm like, this douchebag is not likable at all. But then
which guy was
then
that?
The guy from the Zoot Suite.
What, the vaguely Latino kid?
Yes, okay. Yes. but then it turned
he's
out...
He's sort of ethnic-ish.
It turned out to be like... this sort of ensemble piece that it was, and definitely much grander in scope than I had anticipated, and that's when I really started to enjoy it. Particularly when all these wonderful faces, you know, it's like fucking Spielberg just got like, you know, won like the Nickelodeon Toys R Us shopping spree of fucking actors, and he just got to push the fucking shopping cart through
right.
like the aisles of like cinema and just be like, yeah, okay, give it like you know, spare no expense, everybody I ever liked,
he could do whatever he wanted. He had anybody he wanted. He's writing his own ticket here.
No, they didn't do it on a show. They did it. You're thinking maybe it was a supermarket sweep.
Yeah.
But the Nickelodeon did it as a contest. Anyways, the photography I noticed too. Very soft focus, but also I felt there was a lot of like really like awesome Spielberg-y looking shots. You could tell it was Spielberg.
You definitely could mention that because some scenes were soft focus. The scenes between John Belushi and the pilot fetish lady's airplane.
Nancy Allen.
That was crisp, clear photography.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it was a directorial choice or the second union went, fuck this soft focus shit, yeah. man. We're going to show everything. We worked our asses off on this.
Well, either way, like particularly some of the shots of the Ned Beatty, Lorraine Gary house, I was just like, man, if I didn't know any better, I'd know this was Spielberg. So I enjoyed that about it. It reminded me of a ton of other films. I wrote a list when we watched it, but in the interim, it's fucking disappeared. So
Are
I can't.
Serious?
But yeah, dude, yeah, I should have left it on the goddamn pad.
It's not on the back.
Among them, Inglourious Bastards, and yeah, of course, it's a Mad Men world. Just really quick, Tim Matheson was like exactly like his character in To Be or Not to Be.
Yeah, pretty much the same type of guy.
And another interesting thing is I felt like I was – I somehow felt like – and maybe this is why he was a big deal at the time, but I somehow felt the entire film like I was waiting for Belushi. Like, not like everything was pointless, but the whole time I felt like he was like naturally the – like should have been the star of the film.
That's kind of what I felt too, and that sort of added a little bit to the disjointed feeling is that he's so kind of barely in it.
Right.
But then you almost feel like he's the one you're waiting to see.
No, but he is he's
on the movie poster, but like the entire movie he's like it's a subplot of himself.
Yeah, and it's not connected to the rest of the plot.
Right,
at all.
Which is a bummer because like I just feel pulled, I just feel drawn to him as sort of the centerpiece or the should be the centerpiece and I wonder I just felt like the whole time I was like waiting for Belushi to come back. Not to say that I didn't like it, though. We had a hilarious, fun time with it. I got to give it 3 stars, but we still it was a great film to watch here. We all had a blast with it, and it was really fun. It was really fun viewing with other film fans because it's like, oh, we all get except Kenzie and Jason. We, you know,
no, I fucking love this. What are you talking about?
No, I just mean like geeking out over the famous faces, the familiar faces.
Slim Pickens doing his Doctor Strange.
Right.
Oh, exactly. I knew who he was.
Well, but there's a lot of folks.
See, to answer your question, Zeb, that is shows why it had the gravitas that it should have been the 100th movie because
it
totally did.
That question was answered. There you go. Very well.
All right, so before we get balls deep into 1941 here, just a quick rundown of, and this is not all of them because I decided just to stop fucking writing because I got to people that like I didn't even recognize, and I'm like, I don't have time to look all these motherfuckers up. here we go. We got Dan Aykroyd, Ned Beatty, John Belushi, Lorraine Gary, Murray Hamilton, Christopher Lee, Tim Matheson, Nancy Allen, Warren Oates, Robert Stack, Treat Williams, Tashir Mifune, John Candy, Eddie Deason, Slim Pickens, Wendy Jo Sperber, Michael McKean, Joe Flaherty, Elisha Cook Jr., Penny Marshall, Jimmy Caan, or James Caan, I guess. Mickey Rourke was actually in this. John Landis is actually in this. And, of course, Dick Miller.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about Dick Miller.
Which one was Mickey Rourke?
You forgot Squiggy.
He's like a smaller, he's a soldier.
His first appearance is a cameo.
Yeah, he's like just a soldier
or something.
He's like in
the fight scene.
He's in the Zoot suite.
Yeah.
And John Landis was the dude on the motorcycle.
Yeah.
I got a message.
He's like, I got
without his beard. Right. Without his beard.
Ah. He's like, okay. The message is like, you're going to kill Vic Morrow.
That's
funny because we were just talking about that. All right, there's a couple of things we can talk about in 1941, so I'm just going to run some shit up the flagpole and see what
flies. Are we getting balls deep now?
We're getting balls deep now. Okay, so, well, I think the big thing we want to tackle right now is in the age of internet social justice activism.
Boo!
Let's talk about the sexual predator aspect.
PC principle.
Let's talk the sexual predator, okay? Tim Matheson trying to get laid to Nancy Allen. Is he really a sexual predator? And isn't the real sexual predator that other dickhead that is trying to constantly fucking rape the other chick that's trying to date the guy from the Zoot suite?
You know, it was funny. I was thinking afterwards that the girl, the true rapist really in that situation with the girl with the Zoot suite it was almost like a Popeye cartoon, right?
Yeah, and then like and the how, guy, like, and the Navy guy was...
He was like Bluto. Like, he whatever, comes in, Navy, right? But... And at first she's kind of like, oh, like he's like kind of handsome. He's like a soldier, and she's kind of like into it.
Yeah.
But then when she finds out what he's really after, then it's like, you know, she wants Popeye to come save him. Her, I mean.
Yeah, exactly, right? Like, don't even get me fucking started on olive oil, dude. I've been watching, and I... Dude, she is just evil incarnate. The way she pits those two guys against each other, they should be
beating her up. Yeah,
they should turn on her one of these times.
Dude, Popeye should learn
shove
better.
That can of spinach right up her fucking ass.
Dang, holy shit!
I get very worked out about olive oil.
I hear you absorb spinach faster that way.
Okay, but no,
No, I mean obviously, I'm just kidding. Like it's, I'm not. I don't think that Tim Matheson was really. Obviously, she was into it. You know,
Wendy
I mean,
Jo
some
Sperber
girls,
was the rapist of
some girls have their certain peccadillos, and obviously all you have to do is get on a plane. That actually, I kind of like that too, because that story angle sort of seemed like had like a vintage feel to it. Like, that would be kind of this kind of story you would hear about during wartime.
Seemed
like some girl
like
who
World
was
War
like,
II
during
piece.
World War II, especially because of like, you know, how like impressive the soldier guy was and the almost the propaganda with promoting that idea to get guys to join the military.
Right.
So the idea of this girl, like, oh, yeah, like, she's daft about pilots. Just get her on a plane. She's good to go. You know, like, that seems sort of like almost authentic.
Right.
To a movie from that era. Because I heard that Spielberg did, he did try to shoot it like it was a movie from the 40s on some level. Like, he wanted to
maybe
have
maybe that's
feel.
Why the soft focus.
Maybe. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But yeah, but that, you know, and that, I thought that had that vibe, sort of.
So, anybody, do you have an argument for him being a predator of some kind?
It didn't bother me. I mean, he's a little scary, but.
But the other guy was worse, right? The other rapist guy that dragged her under the tank?
Oh, that's who I'm talking about.
Oh, no, no.
Yeah.
Okay. Didn't bother you?
No.
That's how, dude, no, that's how she would, she's like, would
that's
she was into that.
On.
Yeah. She was exactly like the Wendy Jo Sperber character. In this, where like the one who he wasn't into but was like wouldn't let go of his leg,
yeah,
oh, yeah.
That
that's
was
100%
like
me,
right?
It's really sad, actually. Right.
So, okay, all right, so I guess Tim Matheson, good news, you're cleared,
yeah,
yeah.
You've been absolved of these charges.
Why?
It's
yeah.
not like he's forcing her against her will.
Yeah, that's it. No.
She was ready to go by the end. She knew what she was doing.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
They were both into it.
Okay,
it was
all right.
Consensual.
All right, well, then let me
you
toss.
Can't rape the willing.
Let me. The only thing to call it was consensual rape. man. Whoever thought this motherfucking thing would get so dark? Like, we're talking about like a lighthearted Spielberg comedy, and we're all like.
Rape.
We should well, go.
All right, let's get the hell. Let's get away. Yeah, let's get away. Rape. Okay, yeah, let's do the next topic. I'll toss out to the group here.
So rape.
how do you stand?
So what about abortion?
That's what was next. No, seriously. Okay, so if this film was a passion project of Spielberg's, why do you give a fuck about trimming for length?
Because the studio still wants to make their money back. It wasn't his dough.
No, but you think that okay, I can't see the runtime of a film unless it's so ridiculous that like it becomes a thing in the press, like, holy shit, the new Spielberg film is like 7.5 hours.
They were just worried that 2.5 hours is too long.
But what I'm saying is 2.5 hours is not an outrageous length, right? It's not like it's
yes,
gonna it be
is.
In the advertising for
how long
you.
Was this film? Was
it's like
it
2 hours, hang on, I've got it right here. It was, drum roll please. Oh, damn it, where did it go? Son of a bitch.
I mean, does it actually...
So let's just say it was 2 hours.
Yeah, it was probably right about like right around 2 hours.
Do the theaters
was like
make
average...
less money on a longer movie?
Well, mind you,
well, they
do
fewer showings. The theaters, okay, but theoretically, the theaters say they don't make money off the showings, but the idea is... The longer a film is, the fewer showings a day a movie can do, so the less money
right.
it will theoretically make.
And they didn't really have too many multiplexes back in the day.
1 hour,
could,
58 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah, they had way more single screens.
So if they had it a 2 hour film, they could say, all right, we could have like 5 showings a day.
Yeah.
As opposed to a 2.5 hour film, they could say, well, we're going to have to pare that down. Less money for the studio, less money for the theater owners.
But
back then, well, now if he had like films like, I don't know, like It's a Mad, 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 Mad World, where they made it such a spectacle to go to the movies back then because, you know, they were trying to compete with television. Mm-hmm. They had an intermission and everything. That's why the joke in Monty Python and the Holy Grail was so great, because when people saw the intermission, they're, you know, all right, intermission time.
Yeah, right.
And then, whoop, the movie's starting.
Yeah.
which today's audience would not get.
Well, okay, yeah. here's what I'm saying, though. Then I think then to me that seems like illustrative of the disconnect between studio and artist, because –
I say illustrative.
Well, because think about it. Like, you have to know what you're dealing with here. Like, you got to go, okay, like, this. I would imagine if you were on set, if you're with Spielberg, if you're seeing the dailies, if you've got some idea of what's going on with this film, you're going to know, okay, this is not something that is going to be, this is not the next fucking Jaws. All right. This is not the next Close Encounters, whatever the fuck. So we've got to find a way to make this work for us. So
that's
true. Now,
the length time is one of the reasons.
Well,
why
no, but instead of doing that, why not embrace it and sort of try to put a different spin on it as being like, you know, opposite from Jaws.
You're getting more for
and
your
give
money.
Him and give him and give him. Just let him have his, you know, way and let him put out the film he wants to put out and market it more to like the art house or market it.
Well,
more
but
to,
I mean, that disconnect still exists. I mean, today there's always that problem with the people who have the money to make the decisions have no concept of art. And the people who make the art really have no concept of the money.
They should have
because
just,
yeah. The artist Heaven's doesn't Gate. Care about how much it costs, and Heaven's the Gate. Guy giving up the money doesn't really care about the art. He just worries about the money.
They should have just raised ticket prices globally, and then they could still make money on longer movies, but then still show short movies also.
Well, I mean,
or charge a portion to the runtime. Shorter films, you pay less. Longer films, you pay more.
Prorate the films.
You pay per minute.
You pay by act or
if
something.
You leave early, it's like you validate your ticket and they give you some money back.
You pay by actor.
Yeah.
No, this was around the time that many of these directors were kind of making their big bombs. Stuff that really drained the studios and killed the studios.
But I think that's because the 70s, and maybe I'm, you know, I've got the, you know, the rose-colored goggles on. But, I mean, it seemed to be a time, cinematically speaking, of such kind of exploration that even the guys who were sort of established studio guys probably caught that bug. You know what I mean? I mean, it's not uncommon to hear, you know, cinephiles or film fans or whatever talk about the greatest decades in the history of cinema as being like the 30s or the 70s. So, you know what I mean? Like, it's just funny that all those guys are, like, making these bombs, but that, I mean, this was good. You know what I mean?
No. You lost.
Yeah.
You don't have to get started.
Use shorter words next time.
Well, I think, too, it was ahead of its time. I mean, it's got a cult following now. I mean, people do love this movie now. It just didn't set the box office on fire.
But it's not. That's what I'm saying. Well, I mean, I don't know. I guess with all the explosions, you would think it would, but maybe.
Well, and it's also expectations. Like, it's for a Spielberg movie, it's not enough for it to make your money back or even a small profit. You want to make double or triple your money.
Sure.
I mean, that's why you have like the two Hulk movies. I mean, those made profits, but they're still considered failures because they didn't have this massive record-setting opening weekend and they didn't make them back four times their initial investment.
I'm always going to side with the director over a suit going like, yeah, trim it. Anyways.
I agree. Well, I think, like I said, it would have been better if they had left it alone.
All right, so let's call the cast of this thing a super cast. Even though things have devolved into a fucking phone party.
Phone party.
Are you serious? Phone party?
Yeah.
I contributed what I had. Nothing more.
Dude, fuck that. This is a no cell phone zone, motherfucker. Shit.
You're only burning up your airtime for how long the podcast can be.
Dude,
by complaining.
I got limitless time because I can edit with Audacity.
hey, no trimming.
This whole conversation is never going
to
happen.
Because also the idea is not to just contribute once and then sit out. The idea is to contribute as much as possible. But anyways, all right. So the next thing.
Whatever. What's the next?
So
next issue.
Let's call this. Let's
super
call
cast or super boredom.
Super cast.
Right. Never mind.
When we return.
I just wanted to go around and see if anybody had other favorite supercast films.
Ooh.
Other great. Okay. Because for someone like me, obviously, as mentioned earlier, seeing Slim Pickens, Toshirô Mifune, and Christopher Lee share scenes together was, you know, just a joy.
Cannonball
other
Run
movies?
Comes to mind.
Yeah.
Like Valentine's Day and New Year's Eve, because Ashton Kutcher is in that. And Like everyone else too.
But is that a
everyone
well,
in that
ensemble
movie.
Cast?
Yes, yeah, actually,
it is.
Unfortunately,
yeah. Unfortunately, that's
Jessica
a valid answer.
Biel.
Yes, unfortunately, it is.
The girl from Glee. Some people.
Yeah, that is that. Okay, there you go.
No,
well,
but I agree with Chris. I think the Cannonball Run.
Absolutely.
Yeah, both of them really.
Even though two is infinitely, or one is infinitely superior to two, they're both still
supposed to be good.
two just is missing something that one has. You can tell, like, it's kind of like they were like, this one's for the paycheck.
It's so hard. It's so hard to do the same thing twice.
Yeah, yeah. And not, I mean, don't get me wrong. There's some like wonderful stuff in it. You know, the money or it'll blow you away.
Like,
it was,
in a way.
It's been mentioned twice, but it's a mad world. Probably the ultimate ensemble cast.
Okay,
movie.
Sure. I was thinking of Harlem Nights.
Yeah?
Even though that's the film itself is a sort of questionable... Sort of.
That's another one where you've got almost like this, where you've got all the pieces to make a great movie, and they just didn't put them together in the right combination.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
You had a good movie, but just not a great.
Yeah,
one.
But you had a hell of a cast.
A great cast.
Skidoo.
Yeah.
Technically, yeah.
Great.
Good.
Cast
good
there.
Call on that one. Yeah. quite a varied cast.
Yellowbeard,
well.
Which you mentioned because of the rape jokes, but also a powerhouse.
Well,
cast.
And sort of an unprecedented meeting of popular comedy
from
teams
both sides
of franchises. I mean, you had the Monty Python guys. You had Peter Cook.
Cheech and Chong.
You had Cheech and Chong. You had Nigel Planner of the Young Ones. You had Madeline Kahn from Mel Brooks.
Yeah, there was a lot coming
and
together.
And Peter Boyle.
There's probably a lot of Mel Brooks.
Kenny Mars. You had tons of great...
almost every Mel Brooks, really, is
a... Is a great ensemble
piece. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, that's true, too. He does... he certainly does cast his films well.
Not that they're...
looking up information, but I want to say Around the World in 80 Days. The first one. Which many considered the first big, huge ensemble cast because of the various cameos that popped up in it.
Right.
Oh.
I know, like, Frank Sinatra was, like, that caught everybody by surprise that he was in it. But, yeah, it had, like, Robert Morley, Noel Coward, John Gielgud, Charles Boyer. You know, these people, Cesar Romero. Some of these people, like, their names have already been forgotten, but back in the day,
they were big.
They were like, oh my God, you know, Ronald Coleman, holy shit.
Yeah, Van Johnson, Van Heflin.
And then another one I would argue is The Longest Day, about the D-Day invasion, and it had a lot of men on a mission type actors in it. Everybody from like John Wayne and Lee Marvin to Red Button.
All the old school badasses.
Yeah.
Well, it's funny too, because it is possible that a lot of these, like, the guys weren't, you know, super duper awesome at the time, but like then they had a career, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like at the time it was like a super cast. It just became that over time.
Yeah.
Like,
it's almost like recycling in a way. Well, sorry, not that's not shit. But I was just thinking it's like the Expendables.
I was just going to bring up the Expendables.
Oh,
which
yeah.
It's made
yeah.
now, and we're like, you're taking all these ensemble casts, right? When really, you know.
An ensemble cast movie.
Well, to like, Kenzie.
More like the B-Team ensemble.
Are there any Disney Channel
leftovers.
Original movies that feature like a bunch of stars of other Disney Channel original movies?
The Expendables, because nobody's spending.
Well, no. Hocus Pocus has Sarah Jessica Parker and Bette Midler, right?
But they're not. They're in other Disney Channel original movies too.
No,
like they don't have like a Disney Channel original movie that has like a bunch of characters from other Disney Channel original movies like in the same movie together.
No.
Okay.
Musical ensembles.
Unless they're sequels to each other.
Rat Race is one that's kind of.
Oh,
it's, not,
yeah,
it's not a great
Rat
ensemble
Race.
Cast.
I was gonna talk about Rat Race, but I just hate that movie so much compared to what is.
It blurs
the
line.
The part with the Hitler car is totally funny.
Barbie, that's the best part of the whole movie.
I just keep comparing it to it's a mad.
Well,
they just don't.
Yeah, I haven't seen any of the ensemble ones you've mentioned.
Well,
so
we could mention. I think we could safely mention the films of Wes Anderson as well.
Oh.
Films like Grand Budapest and Life Aquatic.
Yeah.
Or even like Royal
Tenenbaums. Mars Attacks.
Oh,
that's another really good one.
Yeah, excellent.
But Wes Anderson typically has a pretty tend to do pretty good ensemble pieces.
You know, that brings up a good sorry, the hell
it's
that
all right.
One.
Even his Fantastic Fox.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, that's more like a I don't know what it is. It's like a but like it's like a group of people making a movie, whereas like the true ensemble piece is like.
Oh, I see. You're suggesting that like a Wes Anderson like
Adam,
has more of like a
Adam
troop.
Sandler or like yeah, like a troupe. It's like a troupe movie,
like Judd Apatow.
Yeah, yeah. Kind of.
Wait, you're saying Wes Anderson's a troupe movie?
I think that's more.
But his vision is so singular. Like he's the guy who decides how it.
No, but he, has, I mean, so
he has like a stable of actors that he uses.
He relies on all the time.
I mean, but maybe that's what he like the way you know like.
No, but like the, but then regulars. It's not like a. I don't think it's a criticism.
It's not really, no, it's not. It's just that.
I mean, he has these great ensembles, but they're from a stable of cast.
Exactly.
Yeah, but
right. That he keeps using it. But it's very interesting to, if you look at all of Wes Anderson's films, how he uses this large stable of cast members that he draws from: Steve LaCasale, Bill Murray. Such and such,
but
how he puts him into different types of roles in all of his films. Like Bill Murray goes from being basically a cuckold to being the leader of a Jacques Cousteau type to being a concierge at a hotel. And it's very interesting how Wes Anderson kind of shuffles around like the roles. Like, all right, you're a leading man in this one, and you're just a schlemiel in this.
Right,
one,
you know? But he's using a lot of the same people. But Kurosawa did that as well, though. Kurosawa absolutely. You see many of the same actors appear in Kurosawa films from time and time again.
So is it not an ensemble film if they're not if they're doing different things every time?
No. Well, I think
it's one of those movies that blurs the line. Like the same way Adam Sandler movies would be like on the other side,
if we call like a supercast like an actual real thing, I think that there could be a distinction between
JFK.
Two. Because
Walter Matthau and John Lennon were in it.
Yeah.
And John Candy in the back role.
But I'm not sure I see the distinction. Just because they don't do their typecast, that means it's not ensemble.
Well, it doesn't make it not an ensemble, but it's like it's just kind of a little different than something where you have like, say, like Cannonball Run, for example. Just to grab an example, quickly, where these aren't people that have necessarily really worked much together before in
it's almost
this
purposeful
capacity.
That way.
It's like you're bringing together like. All like a different worlds. Kind
it's like worlds
of.
Colliding.
It's like
you know what I mean. Because like with it's a mad world. That would be another good example because like you know they wanted to Stanley Kramer wanted to shove as many comics into it as he could.
Yeah.
So it was like the film became sort of a who's who of comedy at the time.
To the point where like every comedian who was a big deal going back to the 30s
almost
until then,
appeared like, in it, and it wasn't like they were going to go on to do stuff together. So it was more kind of like a random kind of one-off thing. Or like Who Framed Roger Rabbit, even. Having all these cartoon characters that you could never get together again.
It's just for that one time.
It's
almost like that's the real driver, is that not necessarily you have this celebrity that has this, like, you know, grandeur or whatever, like super fame, or like somebody who can play a lot of different roles really well, because, you know, he obviously uses actors that are like, really good. I mean, Goodman,
absolutely.
Everybody can really drive home comedy or drama. You know what I'm saying? But it's like the worth in their movie in a like a real, in my opinion, like ensemble movie is that they have their own world that they kind of exist in. Like,
and it's like a merging of worlds.
Yeah, and
like
it's not
a collision
even
of worlds.
There. It's like they bring their world with them, and they kind of go out of the way to do that. You know what I'm saying?
Whereas, like with Wes Anderson, it's more like a Wes Anderson universe.
Oh, yeah, you're taking...
You know what I mean, kind of.
One's like you're changing the clothes on the doll, and the other one's like you're just mixing the dolls into the same playing field, you know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, all right.
I don't know. I like Wes Anderson ensemble films.
Okay, so let's see. One of the last things I wanted to get to was it didn't bomb, but it didn't meet expectations. Where is the truth about this film? Where does it rank among Spielberg's Ove? And is this Spielberg's greatest cast?
I would argue it's his greatest cast.
I think definitely his greatest cast, yeah.
But I mean,
is it a classic?
Maybe not in terms of powerhouse performances, but just in terms of like
just
wow
by name
factor.
Alone, yeah. Just if you're going to put up on a marquee,
yeah.
This has got the biggest names to draw people in.
What defines a great cast, though? Is it the performance by the cast or the number of the cast?
I would just say the diversity of the cast, because you have a lot of dramatic actors, foreign actors, comedic actors. Both young and old.
Okay.
Well, a lot of legendary people. Yeah. I mean, someone like Shira Mifune, who's just a Christopher Lee. I mean, you just got these people who are at the time
bringing
well
a lot of experience with them.
Although, you know, like, they didn't do like that, especially Christopher Lee. Like, it was, I mean, he was pretty all right, but you didn't need Christopher Lee for that.
Well, okay, that's true, but it was cooler for having him. That's for sure. But having some nameless guy, you wouldn't.
I could definitely see like being disappointed, like Kenzie, if like I knew who all these people were, and be like, "Wow, I was expecting like some like at least a little bit more like artistic scenery chewing."
I can see that. I can see that. So among Spielberg's films, because I mean, this is certainly not the best. So I don't know, like. I mean, I could say it was my favorite cast, but I don't know if I could say it was like the best, because when you look at other films that he's done, that if you're going to rank this among his films, you're stacking it up against. It's got the chips fucking stacked against.
Oh
it,
yeah, well, it's
going, I mean, don't get me wrong, I had a great time with this film, but it, you know, this is no E.T.
Yeah.
This is no fucking Raiders. This is no Color Purple.
Close
Schindler's
Encounters,
List, you right. know, yeah, job, like, you know what I mean? Like,
even Poltergeist, which he technically didn't direct, is still more
like
of a Spielberg movie than
1941.
Yeah, so, I mean, how does everybody see this fitting among his films? You know, I mean, is
well,
it,
I
could
rank many other films of his higher.
Is it, so it's sort of, do you think it deserves basically the reception it got? Like, even though disappointing at the time and, like, we liked it, like, in retrospect, was it appropriate for the quality of the film overall?
I think it kind of deserves the cult following that it has now.
Right.
Maybe at the time it would be like, if, let's use Wes Anderson because we brought him up. Mm. If Wes Anderson has all these films, he follows up Grand Budapest Hotel with some horror movie that's really bad.
Right.
You know, we would all be like, hey, let's go see it because it's a Wes Anderson
Absolutely.
Film. And then we'd be like, what the hell was that all about?
Yeah.
You know, something that doesn't really, it's kind of like how I felt about Death Proof. After seeing, like, you know, Jackie Brown and Pulp Fiction Kill Bill, and it's like, Death Proof, what the fuck was that all about? Yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, maybe over time,
too, that, like, when it gets that cult following is because people, okay, if you went to see it when it opened in theaters, you're going to have these expectations that it's not going to deliver on. But then maybe, you know, the next generation of people are just people who just didn't catch it. Then later on, you run it on video and you see it, and it's like, oh, like, you don't have those expectations. So then
and you can just kind of appreciate it
right,
for what it is.
Right, you appreciate it more, and it doesn't have to impress you quite as much.
Yeah exactly. I mean, I appreciate this movie now. I mean, it makes me laugh, but I could see myself, like, back in the day, if I was, you know, old enough to, you know, really
to
remember,
like,
seeing
it when it came
out.
Well,
yeah, yeah. And to be a Spielberg fan before this movie came out.
Yeah.
Yeah, we might need to get Phil in this.
Yeah, I know. Right? See, like, you went and saw Jaws and you saw Close Encounters.
Yeah,
like, oh,
and I'd be super
coming.
Hyped to see this movie,
yeah,
and then
yeah.
I could see myself being kind of disappointed.
Right, right, and maybe
you know.
Quite
so I mean, I think it kind of deserves like
you wanna,
the spot that it's in, where
yeah,
it's still like in the pantheon of Spielberg movies,
and
but
it's quality movies.
Yeah,
just
something's got to be on the bottom.
Right.
You want to chime
and
in, Phil,
you know, despite the cast.
I just remember that movie, hating it when I was a kid. It was just awful. I'm like, what is this? I mean, after Close Encounters and Jaws and, you know.
That's true. Really, it is nothing. I mean, even the story.
Yeah.
It really, I mean, but everybody does that. It's kind of like the, it's almost like the sophomore, what do they call that? The sophomore curse or whatever. That
the
was
sophomore
his.
Slump.
Yeah.
Yeah, his like, sophomore slump.
I mean, it probably is his worst film. I'm trying to think of. I'm trying to think of his worst film.
And that's the one that's coming to mind.
To my mind. Yeah.
How long has it been since you've seen it?
Jurassic Park 2 isn't.
Oh yeah, that might be up there with it.
That one is actually also forgettable too. I forget that movie was even made.
Yeah, I would rank 1941 higher than Jurassic World, Jurassic Park 2, and Minority Report.
I didn't see more recent ones. I would put it above. For
like
sure.
Always, I didn't really care for Always.
I understand that's supposed to be one of his worst.
I actually like that movie.
Was it good?
It's sentimental.
You're the only person I know that's seen it.
Really?
Yeah. I remember it's against the Richard Dreyfuss and John Goodman and Holly Hunter, right?
Right. Dreyfuss mm-hmm. dies, and basically his ghost is kind of lingering around.
Right.
Oh, that's the jet, the firefighter.
Okay.
One?
Yeah. I would rank this over
basically
over
his
Hook.
Ghost is trying to get his
oh,
ex
yeah.
to hook up with a hot guy.
Oh, okay. So it's like Guy Ghost.
Oh.
Guy Ghost.
Guy Ghost.
Okay. Well, that's gonna shut the fucking door on 1941. Actually, the door will be open a crack because Condi should be back with us next week. We discuss whatever we watch tonight, and he'll be able to
tell his tale.
And also, really quick before we go, something I did want to bring up. People are listening to us out there, and thank you if you do. Feedback has come down, and the word classic is an adjective to describe everything is officially verboten at the Cine Marijuana Theater.
Okay. I'll break out my thesaurus.
Nobody,
then.
Please. Nobody is to call a film classic again.
Can you put up a sign?
Unless, I know, right? I know, we're going to have to come up with some sort of, we're going to have to hook fucking like electrodes and get little shocks.
Except have like a big button.
Except for it's gonna be like a Simpsons.
Then they go to the family.
Dr. Marvin Monroe.
Or like it'll be like Pee Wee's Playhouse with Conky, and we'll all be like, everybody scream if they hear somebody say classic. Classic is unless you're referring to classic cinema like of the old times, 20s, 30s, 40s. It's okay to reference to classic cinema that way, but to describe a film as a classic is now fucking right out. Heed that shit. All right. So until next time, when we watch whatever we discuss whatever we're gonna watch right now. I'm Ed.
I'm Zeb.
I'm John.
I'm Kenzie.
I'm Jason.
And there's Chris.
Skittles. I said I'm Jason.
Oh, did you? Okay. Yeah. and Skittles.
The theme song's not ready to go.
No, it totally is. It totally
the
is.
Outro music.
We'll see you next week.
Yes, there you go. The Cine Marijuana Theater.
The Cine Marijuana theatery music. Goodbye.
Sounds so much better at the end.